Hey, listen, this Nitro wasn't that bad until the third hour.
Third hour. Okay. Right.
The first hour and the second hour were not terrible. The third hour was fucking atrocious.
And it felt like 5 hours.
The Raw show. Here's the thing with the Russo gun. Raw is now a little bit better. The matches are a little bit longer. The people don't give a shit because for the last year, they've been told these matches don't matter. So it's going to take a while to recondition those people. Mm. But overall, it's like a much better wrestling show now. Okay. The current Raw. It's this show was not a perfect show, but it was the best Raw that they've had in a long time.
All right.
This Nitro show is absolutely positively more exciting.
Absolutely.
It is new.
It is.
There's no doubt about that.
Definitely more exciting.
It is not the same show we've seen six times this summer.
But this kind of show absolutely cannot be 3 hours.
I am 100% convinced that they had to hire 10 new cameramen because they didn't have enough cameras before because Russo had so many cutaways to the backstage and to the outside. And you can see his slimy fingerprints all over the show.
Show's brutal.
Fine choice of words.
Brutal by the third hour.
Well, we won't get there eventually if we don't start now. Monday Nitro number 213, October 18th, 1999.
Russo has risen, I wrote.
Yep. A limo arrives. Sid gets out with some geeks in suits. Anyone ever looked less comfortable in a suit than Sid, including myself?
I'm pretty uncomfortable usually, but
it's up there.
So it was in fact the debut of the debut of Vince Russo on Nitro or writing Nitro, and you can tell because how did it open? Pyro and Ballyhoo.
Hey, it was Pyro and Ballyhoo.
Also, Pyro and Ballyhoo. Juventud Guerrero wrestled Evan Courageous for 2 minutes, and then Bret Hart walks out and just starts cutting a promo.
Yeah, but you know what? Hoovy and Evan did not know that Bret Hart was going to walk in.
What?
I'm not even
that is why when Bret Hart walked in, they just stopped and they stood there and they stayed in the ring. I guess thinking maybe somebody will tell us what to do.
Well, no one did.
No, they stood there like absolute morons.
So
they didn't attack the guy. They didn't even complain.
No, well, they complained a little bit.
A little.
I bet
at least
we're
asking
later.
Questions. Yeah.
I want to make something really clear. I left the WWF 2 years ago for one reason. I came here to the WCW to fight Hulk Hogan and win the world championship. I've been lied to and filled with more lies one day after another. But a couple of new guys show up and politics starts to take its place again. And they tell me this match with Hulk Hogan is never, ever going to happen.
Yeah, because the storyline that you don't know, because nobody bothered to tell us on the show, is that Russo, I don't know if he sent Hulk Hogan home or Hulk Hogan doesn't like Russo and so Hulk Hogan has gone home.
Hmm.
Hulk Hogan has gone home.
That was clear, actually, by the end of this.
Yeah, but like, they didn't tell you that.
No.
You had to figure that out.
No.
The show sucks.
It does.
Already.
So Bret's rambling on in the middle of this match when Sting comes out to ramble on in the middle of this match.
Got a new shitty haircut.
It's awful, isn't it?
Oh, fuck. It was terrible. It's like when Shawn Michaels cut his hair after he retired in 98, and he cut it like to chin length.
The page boy thing?
Oh, yeah. Horrible.
Yeah. I'm not sure what Sting has. It's a starving artist look, I guess.
It's something like that.
So he says promises do not come true in this business. Nobody cares. Bret was screwed because everyone gets screwed in this business. And then he offers Bret a world title shot tonight. And so he leaves, and Bret leaves. And they go to the announcers. Is the match over? Did the wrestlers ever leave the ring? Last I saw, they were still there.
It just ended.
So the announcers outright say, Vince Russo and Ed Ferrara are here.
From the WWE creative team.
Yeah. Now, can you imagine like tuning into Seinfeld? And Jerry turns to Kramer and says, hey, Kramer, we hired a new writer for our show.
Mm-hmm.
He's writing your dialogue right now. No, because it'd be stupid.
Well, Vinny, you're right. But the whole idea should be that there can be a creative team in wrestling if wrestling is real.
They can do.
They're responsible
nicknames.
For booking the matches.
Sure.
Here's who's going to fight who on the show.
Yeah.
Here's where we're going to go. That's not how they did it on the show.
But yeah, that point is mute because later on, that's all out the window.
Well, more to the point, and there are creative people in promotions of all sorts that you could have here, but why would you announce it? Just may have the, if their product is so good, let the product speak for itself. And I know the answer is because you had to satisfy the ego of these two men.
Well, I also think that everyone's on the internet.
Yeah.
And so everyone will
think that, was clear by the end of the show.
My God, the show will turn around with these two men.
Mike Tenay interviews Sid, who starts to speak and then says,
"Today I have been advised by my legal team not to comment on the subject right now, but I can promise you and everyone else before the night is over, the world will know what is going to happen."
Another limo arrives. It's Goldberg. Sid's lawyers tell him there's no problem.
Sid has to explain to his lawyers what's in the contract.
Yes. Well, he did later wonder why he was paying them hundreds of dollars an hour. Well.
Sid has to explain to his lawyers what's in the contract.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Three of them.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, Dewey, Scrum, and Howe.
Can you imagine?
Disco Inferno versus Vampiro with Lash LaRue on commentary.
Okay, whoa.
Yep.
What?
Yeah, I'm not making this up.
Vampiro is facing Disco Inferno and fucking Lash LaRue is not only doing commentary, he is getting a championship match at the pay-per-view.
Yes, who has he beaten?
Fuck if I know. That's what I'm asking. Russo, what's going on here?
Russo walked through the back door, took one look at the guy and said,
"Yes,
you're the number one contender.
You're definitely an American. I'm giving you a championship match."
And then he went out there and he emphasized his Cajun accent.
Yes.
Oh, God, that was terrible.
Yes.
So the match went 1 minute and Disco Inferno pinned Vampiro clean. That had to suck.
Yeah.
Just start packing your bags and fill out your resume there, man.
And then, actually, he got a big contract from Eric.
Okay.
So they decided they were going to rip it up and give him a contract for less money. So he wanted to quit.
Oh.
I believe that they ended up talking him into staying. He
sticks around for a while.
WWE didn't want him.
Yeah, well. Yeah. So the match goes a minute. Disco wins. Lash beats up Disco. I use the word what, W-U-T, here twice.
Mm-hmm.
I prefer an A.
Yeah. What?
Yeah, you heard me.
Okay.
It's not woot.
It's what?
What?
Zbysko interviews Goldberg. Larry, by the way, is a pretty good backstage interview guy on the show.
Well, what are we comparing him to? The red fucking rooster?
Yes.
Okay, well, yeah, he's better than that guy.
Yeah.
I know you got something to say.
Tell you what, Larry. I don't like Sid, and I don't trust Sid. And I sure as hell don't sweat anything Sid does. So if he brought his lawyers, if he brought the president, it doesn't matter to me. Because 6 days from now, the same thing's going to happen. No matter what happens tonight. Jackhammer, 1, 2, 3, middle of the ring. See you later.
We had a 7 video. Tells the kid,
"Wait, my child. For it is your time. When does our journey begin? On the 7th night, we begin our reign of terror and darkness. WCW. Fear me, you will. Stop me, you cannot."
You know, this...
It's
this...
Yoda! Speaking of which, Tenay interviews Medusa about her evening gown match. She does not want to do it. She's a world champion. She's a professional.
She was teleported from 2018. This is bullshit. I'm a wrestler. I'm not going to do these stupid matches. I'm disgusted. I'm finished. There won't be a match tonight, she says. Yeah. I'm done.
Yeah.
Excuse me. There won't be a match tonight. Yeah. I'm done, she says.
That's what she said.
Okay.
Yeah, she was not a good promo.
I'm going to hold her to that.
I don't know if that was her what.
No, it was a terrible promo.
It was a terrible promo.
It's hideous.
Nitro Girls search continues.
Finally, Stacy Keibler has arrived.
Yes, she has.
So they do the videos for both girls, and Chiquita's very pretty, but she stood no chance against Stacy. And the contest isn't over, right?
We got to vote.
Okay. Before this fucking show's even over, Stacy is with the filthy animals.
Yes.
What?
I don't know.
Well, those charming, I'll tell you. They
must be charming. What if Max actually did marry her?
Now, for those of you that don't get it, Bagwell comes out here.
I mean, Tori, my bad.
Yeah, Bagwell comes out here, and he's being all goofy.
This is not on my format, the announcers say.
He announces that he is the chosen one. Now, for those of you that don't remember, it's because Russo did some interview on some fucking show, maybe been WCW Live, and he really put over Bagwell. Now, they didn't air any of that on Nitro.
No.
They presume that all of the millions of people watching were hardcore WCW Live listeners. Mm-hmm. And so they would have any clue what this fucking guy was talking about here. I forgot till I went back and looked it up. I had no idea what he was talking about.
Didn't you write a book about this?
I did, but fuck.
This would be a revised copy.
I could write a book about every Nitro. You understand what I'm saying?
Sure.
Actually, I'd write a book about every Nitro.
Yeah.
There's a lot of shit that falls through the cracks.
Yeah.
Going back to the video section where they actually showed Chiquita and Stacy dancing. Stacy is the worst dancer ever, and not
what?
Oh, she's horrible.
Oh, she's been dancing since she was a child.
Okay,
badly apparently.
Oh, get out of here!
She did that, like she jumped and threw her leg real high, and then kind of just fell.
There's lots of different types of dancing. Crew.
I just thought it was funny that they fired.
She didn't
Ricky.
Twerk.
She did actually.
Doesn't mean she's a bad. Actually, you're right. Killed my argument. Damn it!
They both did.
It's true.
It's just funny because they fired Ricky Rackman for talking about no ugly chicks, and then this girl that can't dance is getting a job. Because she's hot, Brian.
Yeah! Hello? What does that have to do with Ricky Rackman?
Are you saying this? I don't, never mind. I'm not going to say anything.
Good.
So, what I like is Buff comes out, and it's supposed to be a shoot, going into business for himself.
A shoot.
He hits the ring, Kimberly leaves, and Stacy and Chiquita, who have no idea what's going on, just stand in the corners and smile. No one told them what to do, including Kim.
Nobody was smartened up.
No. So everyone talked about the internet for a while. I wrote here, Goldberg interviews Mona. I don't think that's right. This is a discourse
what?
To me. That's on me. I'll own this. Somebody interviewed Mona. She is all happy about this evening.
She is?
Yeah.
She was a robot.
Well, it's...
You made up emotions based on what she said.
She said it was a wonderful opportunity to climb the ladder.
It is a wonderful opportunity to climb the ladder.
With a big plastic smile on her face.
I am very excited for the evening gown match. I cannot wait.
No, that's fair.
She was already dressed and ready to go. So
like, she's mid-sentence. And suddenly, cut to Kimberly stalking David Flair through the hallways. Just walking through the halls of the building, shouting David Flair's name.
Why?
We never did find
Unclear.
Out.
Unclear.
Why was she stalking David?
We never found out.
I mean,
there was never a good reason.
I mean, I presume there's a Flair DDP match at the pay-per-view, but I mean, they did a shitty job billing that up if that's the case.
Yeah. Sid discusses the rates he is paying the lawyers.
And you're charging me $350 an hour, and I'm not sounding pinchy or nothing. I don't want to sound pinchy, but your jobs are what?
General counsel.
Yes. And also another existing per hour fee.
Yes.
It's okay, but as long as we know what the job's to be done.
The job will be done.
And it will be taken care of.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Vicious.
Mr. Vicious.
Yes, sure, sir.
That made him happy. That was worth his $900 an hour.
Meanwhile, Goldberg put on tape. Harlem Heat versus Conan and Rey Mysterio Jr. Outcome, Tori
what
Kidd
a
and
fucking Eddie. Mess.
Mm-hmm. It was even... There are multiple disasters in the show.
It's a mess of a match. We got Eddie, Kidman, and Tori doing commentary. Eddie's horrible. Kidman's okay. Tori's a mute.
They are trying so hard because Tori was out there. They wanted Tony so badly to be Jerry Lawler and horn out all over her.
Mm-hmm.
He couldn't do it. He's Tony Schiavone.
Well, there was a great moment early in the show when they announced there was going to be an evening gown match later. And Bobby and Tony were so excited to be sitting ringside for this match. They went to high five and they missed.
Yes.
I'm assuming that was all Bobby, because he was Bobby Heenan, but it worked out.
Positive.
Yeah. Let's see. So, meanwhile, the humorous knobs are backstage watching on a monitor.
Thank God you remembered that.
As they're wrestling here, Kidman says Booker T is a great worker.
Yeah, and a great performer. Mm-hmm.
So there's some kind of brawl at the announce desk we could not see. We could hear it, but the camera never showed it. And then finally, two men pin Stevie to win the titles. Right?
Yeah.
And the announcer's reaction
yes,
was...
Yes, Vinny, that's what happened.
I'm making sure. I may have made a mistake in there somewhere.
Well, you know, there was a championship change.
Yeah.
And the people cheered.
Yeah.
And
but the announcer's only
pop.
Concern was, what does this mean for Halloween Havoc?
A goddamn good question.
They didn't care about the news, only what it meant for Sunday's show.
Well, that's supposed to be the big show.
Kimberly Page and her nipples tried to seduce David.
God, he's just ogling her tits. I mean, he wasn't even...
He's a human being.
He wasn't even, like, trying to be a gentleman.
No. And she gave him her hotel key.
She says, DDP's out of town, and I'm lonely.
Mm-hmm.
Here's my It actually had a key card for the hotel. I couldn't believe my eyes. I thought it would still be an old skeleton key because it was 99. I guess they had electronic key cards by then.
It's the future.
Fuck, it was. Felt like it was today.
Meanwhile, interviewing the new tag team champions, there's a party atmosphere in Philadelphia tonight.
Stacy's there.
Stacy's with the Filthy Animals. They're dumping water on Conan and Ray. Everyone's happy. Tori is also there. The humorous knobs arrive, say, we are going to still get a title shot at Halloween Havoc, right? And Conan basically says, we're partying now. We'll figure that out later.
They accepted.
I guess he accepted.
He accepted.
I'm just happy the new champions were, in fact, happy to be new champions. That's a good thing.
Well, you'll be sick of it when there's 18 of these celebrations on every show for the next 3 months.
That's a valid point. Mang versus Hugh Morris. Here was where they were really, really pushing how Sid Goldberg is the main event of Halloween Havoc. The Outsiders show up in the crowd.
Ugh.
These guys are the worst.
Hugh hit some top rope elbows but never went for the pin, and so Mang just got up and hit the death grip and won. Sid was walking backstage, and Goldberg was watching Sid walk backstage.
And then Sid kept walking and came out.
Yep.
Cool. We needed 3 fucking segments for that.
Yeah, yeah. So Sid rips up the contract. Goldberg runs out. He goes to throw a spear. Sid pulls one of the lawyers in the way, and Goldberg spears this dude. His neck, as it turned out, hit the ropes. From the angle, the hard cam angle, it looked like his head hit right into the turnbuckle. And he collapses, and the angle his head was at, looked like detached from his body.
Absolutely.
I thought this man was deceased. And I had forgotten that a lawyer died on Nitro in October of 1999.
Then he stood up.
He got up. I felt better.
Fuck, he was Austin Aries.
He was, actually.
Just jumped right up and got the hell out of the way.
So
I actually liked this angle because the whole thing was, Sid, the contract said that if Goldberg touches Sid before Halloween Havoc, there will be no match.
Mm-hmm.
So last week, Goldberg flipped his lid and he speared the guy. So Goldberg was coming out here, and he ripped up the contract. He says, there's no match. My lawyers are here. It's in the contract. You touch me. There's no match. So Goldberg, like a caveman, runs down to the ring. He's all mad. He goes to spear Sid. He hits the geek. The geek jumps up, probably distracting Goldberg. Sid boots him with his dress shoes, power bombs him, stuffs the contract down his throat, and threatens to kick his ass. Halloween Havoc.
He's like, I'm going to kick your ass. And I'm like, you just did.
Yeah. But he's going to really kick it. And kick it bad.
I see.
But I thought this was a great little angle. Sid winning worst promos in 99 is one of the great disasters in the history of the Wrestling Observer Newsletter.
Absolute crime.
I'm appalled. I'm sickened.
So Sid leaves. Goldberg is coming to as he's making his way around ringside. The Outsiders laugh at him. They throw their toothpick at him, so he fires back, and he punched Kevin Nash in the face.
Yep.
Way harder than Moolah hit May on Raw. So there's a big brawl, and the Outsiders get ejected, and we get like 5 minutes of security leading the Outsiders from the seats through the crowd to the outside. Nash says, I'm sick. Hall doesn't want to leave. It just goes forever and ever and ever. Tanay interviews Brett. He says he'll take any shot he can get, vows to win tonight, and if it's up to him, he'll defend that title against Hulk Hogan at Halloween Havoc. And then Sting attacks him, and they brawl. The Outsiders have not moved. It's been like 15 minutes now. They're in the exact same spot.
Mm-hmm. Nash says his broads paid $1,500 apiece to hang out with us.
Yes.
And then he said he had a cold, and he was drinking cold medicine, but it was probably whiskey.
So they cut inside to an empty hallway. You can't see anything. You can just hear Goldberg. Sid!
Sid!
He comes in. Vicious!
Vicious!
Just to clarify, he's looking for Sid.
In case there's any confusion.
Yes. I'm not making anything about this next segment up.
Fuck, let me read what I wrote, and hopefully you can, like, help me.
I'll do my best.
Rick Steiner versus Berlin.
Good, yeah.
The wall hits Rick with a chair. Berlin gets the pin. Went about a minute. Rick beats up Brad Armstrong afterwards. It's Berlin, Brad Armstrong Sunday.
Sure.
Did I basically get all of it?
But you left out the part where...
Everything?
Brad hit the ring to do nothing but glare at Berlin. So Rick grabbed Brad. The wall swung a chair. Not sure who he was aiming for, but he hit Rick.
Mm-hmm.
So it is both Brad's fault and Berlin's fault and the wall's fault that Rick got pinned. And I'm thinking, Rick Steiner should murder all 3 of these geeks.
Yeah.
He picked one.
He only killed Armstrong.
He murdered Armstrong. Just beat him and 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 beat him. Dragged him backstage. I was sure there's more to come, but no. This was the build for Berlin and Brad Armstrong, while Rick Steiner does not have a match on the pay-per-view.
Yes.
So after spending like 15 minutes of TV time dealing with the outsiders being ejected, they're just back.
Yeah, they snuck in.
They're tiptoeing in. The cameras can catch them. Security can't.
Mm-hmm. What was the fucking point of this?
I have no idea.
Was there any payoff? Did I miss the payoff?
I'm trying to think.
I don't think there was a payoff.
I don't remember.
They dress up as the Vianos. That's the last thing I remember.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the Kevin Nash is drinking sizzurp.
Touche. He was. Kimberly goes to her hotel.
Oh, my God.
She goes to her room. There's somebody taking a shower already. She says, oh, you're... Baby, I'm here. I'm glad you're getting warmed up. I'm getting ready, too. And then she removed her trench coat.
Good Lord.
I was finished.
That quick, huh?
You were wrecked.
I was wrecked. I was wrecked.
Spent.
Demolished. Devastated. Get that thesaurus back open, Rob.
Yeah, we'll get it here.
All of those. Just on sight of this lovely young lady. So, much to her chagrin, she's pouring champagne. I think she had some kind of...
Okay, stop right there.
Mm-hmm.
What was her plan?
I have no idea.
She was slipping him a Mickey.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. She was going to...
She had some kind of pills. I think the plan was to...
Well, now I'm even more...
But she thought it was David.
Now I'm even more incensed.
Why?
So she was going to take David to the hotel,
mm-hmm.
pretend like she was going to fuck him, put a shit in his drink, and he was going to get knocked out.
That was the plan, yeah.
All right. So now you're telling me that Rick...
I have a solution.
Rick showed up instead.
Yeah.
And he didn't drink?
No. No. See? This is where...
This is bullshit.
No, this is
this
where...
This is bigger bullshit than that bag.
This is where years of Ric Flair partying came to...
Oh, he's immune?
It did not affect him at all.
That's possible.
You've got all no right. liver.
I'll get that.
It was nothing to him.
I will accept it.
We're kind of glossing over the part where David Flair looked at this key card and said, I should give this to my dad.
Yeah.
He'll do a much better job than I will. I mean, he probably would.
There was a missing vignette somewhere.
Yeah, so Flair pops out of the bathroom, fully dressed, by the way, with a shower running. That's weird. He's having the time of his life. They can have a party. What did he say here?
Dude, he ran out. He started jumping on the bed.
The boy couldn't make mistakes about good, live and in color. Woo! And tonight, honey, you're going to get the 14-time spanking. Woo! That your daddy should have given you a long time ago.
And then it ends. So I guess Kimberly just said, well, any port in a storm.
I guess. She was lonely.
I guess.
Flair was there.
As far as we know.
Yeah, and he gets back to the building. He made it back to the building. Yeah, this was...
He did not go all night and go a little longer.
This was just weird.
Probably drove. Unaffected by anything that he consumed.
Goldberg's still looking for Sid. He couldn't find Sid, so he killed the Insane Clown Posse instead.
Apparently, it's something about this Goldberg didn't like, and so they wanted to get rid of ICP. It was like a 1 second segment.
Mm-hmm.
They showed up, he beat their asses and laid them out.
Well, that's if he was going to beat their asses, it would take 1 second.
And didn't they get released like 2 weeks ago or something?
Yeah, they're still around.
Right.
They're,
well, obviously.
They must be great in job interviews. Because they tend to lose jobs and then get rehired quickly over and over again. Zbyszko interviews the total package. This was awesome.
Yeah, this was good.
Lex had to pretend he was not shook.
Yes.
Because he's wrestling Goldberg tonight, who tonight is the scariest Goldberg of all time.
Can we start, though, Vinny, by saying what Larry said to him?
You know, Mr. Package, we just saw it. Goldberg's left all the clown's legs beside himself. After 25 glorious years, I wouldn't want to be in your shoes.
He's going through them clowns, and you're next.
And Lex is, he's stuttering, he's shaking a bit, but he says, I've got the muscles, and he looks at his giant muscles. I can take Goldberg, right, Liz? He's just... It's awesome. It's like the best thing Lex Luger ever did, putting on this false, blatantly false front of not being scared.
It was very good.
It was awesome.
Well, you know, Zbyszko, you know, he can beat up all the clowns he wants, the whole Byron Bailey for all I care, because I am the total package. Right, Elizabeth?
That's right.
I mean, I came back looking better than ever off of bicep pain. I've fought through so much adversity. You think him breaking monitors and whatever he wants to do and going and tearing the back, I've wrestled every killer.
The women were preparing for their evening gown match. David Flair versus Kidman. So Tori is now in Kidman's corner, which has David all pissed off.
There's a spot early in this match.
The Avalanche.
David is so fucking terrible. He throws Kimmy into the corner and just runs at him with his chicken chest.
Yes.
And, like, he hits him. And everyone in the crowd is laughing and booing at this guy.
It's so bad they're angry.
Guys, it's creative team business. Been at work here. It's a new direction, and we're loving every minute of it.
Oh, I was dying.
They were in Philadelphia. That was part of it. But.
Fucking A. It was terrible.
So the match continues. Tori flashes David. He covers her up.
And yeah. Heenan says, you should be hit from behind.
Kevin hits him from behind. He hits the...
shooting star.
Well, he hit the powerbomb thing first, and he goes for the shooting star.
Oh, good Lord.
And his knee comes down on David Flair's face.
Fuck.
He didn't have to sell. He just reacted.
He just screamed and grabbed his face.
It's time to retire that move, dude.
Made sure his eyeball was still in.
You're going to kill yourself or somebody else.
Kill somebody else. So, yeah, David Flair having an awful, awful, awful day if you've not been paying attention.
Yeah.
The Outsiders are now looking for Goldberg. They ask Gene. There's some bullshit. Flair arrives back at the building. I'm not making this up. He's pulling up his pants.
Well, I guess it answers that question.
I guess it did.
I mean, I don't know why it takes so long to pull your fucking pants up.
He probably hit the car nude and dressed on the way.
I see.
He's been doing this for a while. Medusa versus Miss Mona in an evening gown match. So what this actually was about 3 minutes of Medusa just tearing her apart. It was awesome.
Well, Medusa comes out in, like, this...
A dress.
Of, sort of a dress. Not, it was definitely not an evening gown.
Something like a tennis player would wear.
Yeah, it was like a tennis outfit, yeah. And Mona's in her evening gown, and they just have a fucking wrestling match there. German suplexes, and then Medusa KOs the ref. Fuck if not. And then she goes for a German, and there's no ref. I'm like, that's your fault. Gets a chair, she's whacking her, and they end up outside, and Mona just yanks her dress off.
Mm-hmm.
And Medusa... It's in her sports bra and her booty shorts. She's furious. She grabs a mic and tells,
"You really think I really wanted this evening gown match? Well, everybody behind here can really kiss my ass, you know what I mean?"
I thought she was awesome here.
Yeah, Medusa's great. And at this point, the announcers ask, "Is this thing over?" I don't know. I don't know. That was the end of the evening gown match. Bret Hart versus Sting.
So
what a weird fucking match.
Well, here's the thing. This was a long match after all of that bullshit. And so there was no way for the fans to get into this until like the very end. They had a fine match. It wasn't bad.
No.
It was technically good.
It probably went, I don't know, at least 15 minutes.
It went through a full quarter hour segment and more.
For at least 12 of those minutes, there was no... They're both heels, really. So there's no one to cheer for. And finally, Sting just hooks a sleeper, and they lay on the mat and say, "I'm going to lay here until people start cheering for Bret." And it was the first time he actually cheered for either man. So Bret gets these sharpshooters, Sting gets the ropes, and then Elizabeth comes out.
Elizabeth comes down to ringside, and Tony Schiavone says, and I quote,
"I try to read her facial expressions. Is she concerned for Sting? Is she happy?"
I was like, that's an inside joke. One face, dude. Yeah. I don't know if she's concerned. She always looks like that.
Concerned.
So she takes the ref. Lex hits Bret with a baseball bat in the leg, and Sting hooks the scorpion. Bret immediately taps out. A weird match. Flair has found his son, but he's very confused. "Where's Tori?" he says. "What's going on? Why are we not in the locker room?" Kim is just out in the boonies, the hallway somewhere. And David has to look up at his father and say...
Me or you arrest a kidman? The filthy animal came down?
Yes.
You talking about Guerrero?
Yeah.
Corian, Becerro, they came down after you, bitch?
Yes.
Come on, man, we got work to do. Come on, kidman.
Ric Flair's reaction to this. He freezes, time pauses, he takes a deep breath, his head dips down. What? He can't process it.
His response is, "Kidman can't beat you up." David's like, "He beat me up. He can't beat you up."
I laughed and I laughed and I laughed. Now he's outraged. Kidman and Conan and Ray and Eddie G throwing his jacket around. They're going to take care of this.
Who's the babyface and who's the heel?
Who the fuck knows?
Jesus Christ.
Dude, that got, by the end, it gets worse as far as muddying that up.
I think, I don't know.
I have no fucking clue.
If I'm Kidman lost. Is the babyface, he is such a jerk.
I think the Filthy Animals are supposed to be
the Filthy heels. Animals, I'm pretty sure, are supposed to be heels.
And David.
So is Revolution, but they're still feuding.
David and Rick are like babyface.
I think they are, yeah.
Okay.
That's the best I can do. Although, well, we'll get to that. The outsiders are walking around. It's now been like an hour. Clearly, security does not watch Nitro.
Now they have the Viano masks.
Yes. No, that was like after the break. There are two back-to-back outsider signals.
Okay.
Yeah. It's time to talk about La Parka and Buff Bagwell. Now, this is one of those things. We talk about things I forget. I had forgotten this until it started. And it was like, I remember every single thing that happens here. Because it was notorious. And it happened exactly as I remembered. So on Thunder, but this was set up, by the way, Buff Bagwell very randomly turned on La Parka on Thunder. I don't know. So Buff comes out. He does not have his hat. He's not doing his dance. He's not smiling or flexing. He's pissed off. There's boring chance immediately. So Buff keeps dominating the action, but keeps letting La Parka up. And when La Parka does stuff, Buff lets him do it, but kind of sort of no-sells it. Certainly does not sell it well. And finally, Buff does a thing in the corner. He does a half-assed version of his wacky dance. He drops to one knee, gestures to Parka, come kick me in the head. Parka kicks him in the head. Parka pins him. Buff is up before Parka is. They cut backstage to show everyone laughing and cheering. And Buff goes to the announcers, grabs the microphone and says,
"Hey Russo, did I do a good job for you? You know what? Who else can beat me? Won't you come down and beat me, big man?"
"Hey Russo, did I do a good job for you?"
Yes, that's what happened.
So he returns to the ring. He lies down again. And he's getting up. Who should make his return to Nitro but Jeffrey Jarrett, who lays out Buff with a guitar.
"Well, let me tell you a little something about stroke. How is it that last night, less than 24 hours ago, I was in Cleveland, Ohio, wrestling on a pay-per-view, and tonight I'm here live on Monday Nitro? Hey, Buff, I got your stroke right here."
Ep nuts.
Oh, God, yeah.
Forgot about that, didn't you?
I did.
This was fucking atrocious. And it's just ridiculous because it's like, we're supposed to believe that Buff was out-wrestling La Parka for real. But then he would let La Parka do some stuff.
Because they was told to.
But then, like, every now and then he'd forget it was supposed to be fake and he'd sell.
I guess.
And then eventually he took the kick and laid down for the pin. So I guess he was told he had to do a job. Uh-huh. I don't know why.
So,
and no, then
he was in there telling everybody that what I do is a joke and it's fake.
No, what he did here was a joke and a fake.
Right.
But he can really wrestle.
Sure.
I don't know.
This is just atrocious.
Like, a dumb idea on paper.
And then Vince Russo, who's been in the company 2 hours, had to get his name out on the airways.
Yes.
Dude, he's Dr. Claw in like 2 weeks. He's coming.
Yep.
He has risen. This was atrocious.
He just...
gotta be a better word for
he
that.
He just wanted to be on TV.
Risen from
he just
the
wanted to be a
depths.
Character.
He's risen. Yeah, from the depths.
This is something the Lord would do.
Really surprised.
Well, he wrote that religious book.
He did, didn't he? I'm sorry, Craig. What was that?
I'm really surprised you guys aren't more angry with this.
Dude, I watched it 19 years ago.
I'm
long since over it. It's dumb. It's stupid.
It's dumb and it sucked.
Yeah. And you know what it was? It was one of those things that I'm sure he wanted to do on Raw 1,000 times, and Vince shot him down every single time.
I'm sure that happened.
And so he had his opportunity here.
No, I have no... control. What's the... don't want to answer to.
I mean, to be fair, I think the storyline is that all of these matches are real, but Russo told Buff that he had to lay down he had to throw a match tonight. That's what the story is supposed to be.
That's still stupid.
It's fucking idiotic.
Dumb.
Security finds the outsiders. I think Nash threw up.
Yes, he did.
Oh, fuck. This was worse than the Buff Bagwell in the Parker match. Eddie Guerrero and Chavo Guerrero and Saturn in an elimination three-way.
On paper, this should have been a good match.
Fuck, I didn't even know it was elimination until...
like 3 minutes in. I was trying to figure out, is it a tag match? Are Eddie and Chavo friends now?
Well, I knew it was clearly a three-way, but then there was a spot where Eddie pinned Saturn, And I'm like,
well, that's
thank,
like 10 minutes in.
Thank God it's over.
Yes.
And then they kept wrestling.
Yes, yes, that happened. So Shane Douglas is on commentary. I thought on the whole he was pretty good. Although there was one point where he said Benoit and Malenko are on a respite in Japan.
He seemed to be not in the best state of mind, I thought.
That's possible.
I could be wrong.
That's possible. I enjoyed him for the most part. There was that one line. So for like a minute, this was just Saturn suplexing two small dudes. And I thought, okay, this rules. And then it wasn't that no more. And they just kept on going and going and going. And stuff just
talking about this stacked up superplex.
The stupidest. Goodness. This may have been stupider than the match with no mats on the pay-per-view.
Why did Perry Saturn get on the second rope for this?
So
that was the whole problem.
So Chavo is going to superplex Eddie into the ring. And now we've all seen 2,000 times the third person will run up and powerbomb the dude doing the suplex.
And they stand on the apron while they're doing it.
They stand on the mat. Yes. Saturn comes up behind Chavo. Chavo and Eddie are basically on the top rope. Saturn comes up behind Chavo and stands on the middle rope. So the idea is that he's going to be standing up on the middle rope with Chavo on his shoulders as Chavo does a suplex. What actually happens is he's standing straight up as Chavo falls back behind him and Chavo falls off his shoulders back onto his neck. I screamed. I promise you, in real life, it's one of those moments where Chavo thought he was dead because he immediately sits up and grabs his neck. Like, he should have stayed down to sell it, but he wanted to make sure he was actually still alive and could move all his limbs.
Perhaps Perry thought they were going to do a delayed suplex.
I don't know. So, as I'm... It's a
delayed superplex?
Delayed... Double superplex.
Double impact superplex.
I don't think that's...
I know, I was making...
Whatever they had in mind, this is not it. Now, so it's a horrible match. We almost have a death. Suddenly, the Filthy Animals are out there picking a fight with a one-armed Shane Douglas. His arm's in a sling. Keeps going and going and going. And then finally, Eddie pins out of the frog splash, and I had the same reaction Brian did. Now, they did mention it was elimination at the start, but I forgot. So when Chavo just kept wrestling him, I was like, oh my God. Chavo hits a tornado DDT on Eddie. Looked like he was legit hurt, and they just went home.
He blew out his rib.
Perfect.
Mm. Yeah.
Perfect.
In this fucking match.
That sucked.
Can you imagine? This Norman Smiley gimmick has started. He's a wimp. He's a coward. He's constantly crying during his matches, yet he wins constantly on flukes. Fans shit, boring. It went for fucking ever.
And Horace, by the way, I know it's the hardcore gimmick, but he beat the shit out of Norman.
Yeah.
And Norman responded with...
Well, that's the gimmick, yeah.
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 That's
so
it's going to get annoying.
I remember it being funny. We'll see how it goes.
For a while.
So Horace, the end is he hits himself with a chair and then put himself through a table and Norman pinned him. So Flair comes out. Now, as noted, we were earlier trying to figure out who was a babyface and who was a heel. The people started calling Flair old. So he started making jokes about the oldest driver, the longest line. And then they're in Philadelphia. So he starts healing on them with hockey references about how the old Flyers are much better than the new Flyers. Everyone boos. But then it's Ric Flair. So once he starts going all crazy, they get back on his side again. Mm-hmm. He calls it the Animals. So they just come out and beat the shit out of him.
Yeah. They run down. They beat the absolute hell out of him. David runs down. They beat the absolute hell out of him. Mm-hmm. And then they robbed Flair.
Yes.
Yes.
On national television.
They stole his watch and his wallet and his shoes. Anything else they could...
At one point, Ray stole his socks. I'm sure they were expensive.
I was going to say, they're probably $300 socks. I mean, if you're going to steal a pair of socks, Flair's the guy to steal them from.
In a very uncomfortable moment...
Oh, fuck.
Lex Luger found Liz unconscious and unresponsive.
Yep.
And it led to nothing.
Well, it's a broken guitar.
Yeah, there was a broken guitar.
Missed that.
Yes, Jared is...
I didn't even see that part.
Jared is still beating up women with guitars, but he's not allowed to actually hit him.
Well, I'm sure Les said, fuck, no, you're not hitting me with a guitar.
Which I'm sure is why the show starts to sink.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You can't show that kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's all damn standards and practices. So I thought this is going to be a setup for Lex having an excuse to get out of the match, but no, he just comes out to fight.
Yep, came out alone.
It was not a very good match, but the heat was awesome.
There's a spot where Luger's getting the heat and Goldberg runs him over and Schiavone says, Goldberg isn't a man. He's a machine.
He's Cage.
I thought Cage was 15 years old watching this in 1999. That had to be where this came from.
Probably was.
Back when he was not the size he is now.
No, he's smaller.
I bet you he's the same size.
No.
Actually, he's not.
I'm kidding.
No, not at all.
When he was in developmental.
Yeah. Yeah, look at him. Look at him like 10 years ago. I would say he was skinny.
He'd be the smallest guy in this room.
He was significantly smaller.
Yeah. So, and he had the Wolverine, still has Wolverine sideburns, but anyway.
You noticed him more when he was skinny.
Yeah, because it was 20% of his body weight.
Yes.
So
now
there's
3%.
There's a ref bump in this match where like Goldberg's like whipped into the corner and sandwiches the ref. And the ref goes down, and Goldberg looks at him with such disdain, like, "You puny human." It's just an avalanche.
You little twerp.
Little twerp. So the outsiders are on stage. Sting is hitting Goldberg with a bat. Bret is fighting with Sting in the ring. The match is Goldberg versus the Total Package. Bret Hart and Sting are fighting in the ring. The ref is on his knees looking at them. As Tony Schiavone says, the referee is still down. He has not seen any of this. So eventually Goldberg hits a spear and a jackhammer and he pins Lex. At least there was a pin.
Well, Goldberg, Luger goes in to save Sting or something. And he puts Bret in the rack. And as he's racking him, yes. Goldberg spears him and then jackhammers him and gets the pin. Which was a cool finish. Fans are pelting the ring with garbage because they thought they were going to get another bullshit finish. And they actually got a finish, believe it or not.
Yes.
And the match itself, I would say a good 10 minutes too long. I mean,
it definitely
if it went 12 minutes, it should have gone 2.
That's fair.
Yeah, yeah.
If it went 13, it should have gone 3. But fuck. Goldberg does not need to be selling for Luger or anybody. So anyway, the story of this show again is it fell off a cliff in hour 3,
uh-huh.
just like Raw nowadays.
Uh-huh.
The difference is that back then they made so little money off television that they could cut the third hour and still try to make their money off pay-per-view and all of those other things. Now there's so much money in TV that WWE cannot cut the third hour of Raw. So we're fucking stuck.